So welcome back. So we discussed briefly about how to define for a curvilinear motion, how to define velocity. Okay, this is position, change in the position, delta r, it's a vector, and divided by delta t is the instantaneous velocity vector, and a corresponding instantaneous speed is given by ds by dt, which is the change in magnitude, okay, the change in the length divided by time. Similarly, for acceleration, the acceleration comes not only because of change in the magnitude, okay, it may come even if there is no change in the magnitude, but there is a change in the direction. And we saw the simple example of a uniform circular motion where the speed remains constant all throughout the trajectory of the particle moving along a circular trajectory, but the velocity direction keeps changing, and as a result there is a normal acceleration. So just one thing is that a velocity, if this is the path of the particle, velocity is always tangential to the path, and the acceleration depends on the rate at which the velocity changes. Okay. So there were a couple of questions about hodograph and so on. Okay. So just please bear, okay, please keep in mind that these are not very important. Only thing you need to know really is how does the velocity direction change. Okay. That is how does the velocity change, including both the direction and the magnitude, and that will give us what is the corresponding acceleration. Or if we make sure that we understand how does the velocity vector change as a function of time, velocity vector, then that will automatically give us what is the corresponding acceleration. Now the simplest way of defining the positions and velocity is in terms of rectangular components. So what you can say is that you can fix a coordinate axis at some origin O, okay, what that origin is you can decide conveniently, fix that thing. Now at any point, okay, you can say that a position is given by x I hat, where I hat is a unit vector in the x direction, y j hat plus z k hat, okay, all these j k are the unit vectors along y and z direction. Now the velocity vector, vector straight away is nothing but dx by dt times I dy by dt j dz by dt k. So this will get, we will get a velocity vector, okay, this is x dot y dot z dot. So vx, vy, vz are the corresponding components of velocity in x, y and z direction. Similarly, to get the acceleration vector, we only need to differentiate once more, and what do we get? We get this as x double dot I plus y double dot j plus z double dot k. So that is the final acceleration. So what we are doing here is that position, velocity and acceleration, we are expressing all in terms of the coordinates, the coordinates of position, coordinates of velocity and the coordinates of acceleration along x, y and z direction. Now the simplest example, okay, and the most common example that we see for such kind of motion in two dimensions at least, okay, is a two dimensional. What do I mean by two dimensional? That it's a planar motion, the particle, okay, travels only in one plane, and so that plane we, without losing any generality, call as the x, y plane. Now in this case, okay, suppose we throw a particle at some angle with respect to the horizontal, okay, fix our origin on the rigid ground, and suppose and when the particle is thrown, there is acceleration that acts on the particle in the z direction, which is the acceleration due to gravity. So what do we have? If we break down the acceleration into three components, then the acceleration in the x direction is 0 for this problem. Acceleration in the y direction, okay, this is x and this is y direction, is nothing but minus g y minus, because our y coordinate is fixed in the upward direction and g is acting downwards, that is why minus. And az, because the motion is planar, we do not worry about what is the acceleration in the direction out of plane, because it is clearly 0, at least for this simple problem. Now suppose we have the initial conditions that x0 is equal to y0 is equal to z0. For the timing, let us forget about z because it is a planar motion. So all the particle begins at the origin. Correspondingly, okay, we say that vx0, vy0 and vz0 is equal to 0. Okay? So these are the conditions that we are providing. So integrating twice, what do we get? We get that vy is equal to vy0 minus gt, vz0 equal to 0. So these are the z motion, we do not have to worry about it. And x will be simply vx0 into t, y is equal to simply vy0y minus half gt square. Essentially, what we are doing is it is as if the particle has velocity in the x direction, velocity in the y direction. So, it has two independent rectilinear motions, okay. So, one independent rectilinear motion in the x direction which has no acceleration, another independent rectilinear motion in the y direction, but in that case there is a uniform acceleration of minus g, okay. So, because there is no acceleration in the horizontal direction, clearly what we had seen is that a motion in the horizontal direction is uniform, whereas the motion in the vertical direction is uniformly accelerated, and these are two independent motion which now can be superposed, okay, and we can say that the complete motion can be broken down into two independent rectilinear motion, one along the x direction and one along the y direction, okay. So, this is how the trajectory will look like, that Vx will always remain constant, Vy will change in this manner, Vy is the motion in the vertical direction, x position, okay, will linearly change with time depending on what is the component initially of the velocity in the horizontal direction, correspondingly what is the component of y in the vertical direction, and if we say that Vz at 0, that is the velocity coming in the out of plane, that is 0. So, what it says is that, with these conditions the motion becomes planar, and this is the x coordinate as a function of time, this is the y coordinate as a function of time. Now, this is a projectile motion, what we have is that initially if we throw this particle, okay, from the origin at with a speed of v naught, okay, which is inclined, okay. So, the vector v naught now is inclined at an angle theta with respect to the horizontal, we have x component given by v 0 cos theta, y component v 0 sin theta, and now we can think of this motion as this motion in the horizontal direction with no acceleration and this initial velocity, whereas with this initial velocity and minus g as the acceleration, motion in the vertical direction. And we see clearly that if you think about this particle only with a motion in the vertical direction, the particle will go up and come down under the influence of this gravitational acceleration, whereas it will uniformly keep moving in the x direction, and the resultant curve that comes out of it, okay, can be seen to be a parabolic curve, and this particular motion is called as a projectile motion, and this is the motion we see, for example, when we throw a stone or when we hit a ball and see its trajectory, or for example, when something is thrown from the top of a building, okay. So, anything that is, for example, acting under the influence of a gravity, we have some initial velocity in x and y direction, then the resulting motion, okay, is parabolic and it is called as projectile motion. We will do a very simple problem, okay, to just see how this kind of trajectories or how the kinematics of particles undergoing this projectile motion is understood, okay. So, the simple problem is that a projectile is fired from the edge of a 150 meter cliff. So, the origin now, okay, is now fixed here, the projectile is fired from the origin of this cliff, which is this much deep, at an angle of 30 degrees with respect to the horizontal, this is the angle, and the velocity, okay, this is the direction which makes 30 degree with respect to the horizontal, and the magnitude of the velocity, or correspondingly the speed, is 180 meter per second. And what we are asked to find out is, we neglect the air resistance, okay. This is very important, because for example, if you would see that there are some cricket bowlers, okay, they bowl a ball, but the ball does not follow a nice projectile trajectory, whereas if it is a good spinner, you see that the ball has sudden dip, for example, and it has a drift. Whereas a good swing bowler, when he puts the ball, when he delivers the ball does not move in a perfect projectile, but it undergoes swing, it undergoes seam. But these are special cases in which, because of the air drag, because of the forces coming from the surrounding air, the corresponding mass or the corresponding body does not have a uniform projectile motion. But as a very, very simple case, okay, if we kind of neglect that, and it is a very decent approximation to the first order, that we neglect that mass. We neglect the drag coming from the air, then the motion is a projectile motion. And now what we are asked to find out, the horizontal distance from the gun here, okay, to the point where the projectile strikes the ground, and the greatest elevation about the ground, okay, how high does the particle go, okay, what is the maximum height it reaches, okay, during the course of its flight. The simple thing, so horizontal and vertical motions are independent, as we had just seen. Now, we apply equations of motion in the y direction. What? We have an initial velocity in the y direction given by 180 into sin 30. There is an initial velocity in the x direction given by 180 times cos 30. So, those are my initial velocities in the y direction and in the x direction. And then, y direction may the motion has initial velocity and gravitational acceleration, whereas in the x direction it is a uniform motion. And then, what we can do is we can find out the time for the projectile to hit the ground. Okay. Why? Because we know that what is the corresponding x, y coordinate and use that time, okay, to find determine this time, and then also find out what is the maximum elevation which will happen when, as we had seen earlier, okay, the velocity component in the y direction becomes 0. To this, what we do is that these are the initial speeds, okay, these are the initial coordinates, x 0 is 0, but y 0 is equal to 150. This is the acceleration in the y direction minus 9.81, acceleration in the x direction is 0. Okay. So, vertical motion is uniformly accelerated. What are the equations of motion? Vy is equal to Vy 0 plus at, simple equation of motion. Putting all the values, this is how Vy looks like. Y, or what is the y coordinate as a function of time, can be written as y is equal to Vy 0, okay, Vy 0 t plus half at square. Simply put in all the values, you will get this is the y expression. Then the next expression we want to know is how does the y coordinate, okay, changes as a function of velocity. So, the third equation, that Vy square is equal to Vy 0 square plus 2ay. So, these are the three equations we get for Vy as a function of time, y as a function of time, and Vy as a function of y. Okay, this is a mistake here, okay, it is a uniform motion, it is not uniformly accelerated, kindly make a correction, it is a uniform motion, there is no acceleration in the horizontal direction. So, Vx 0 is equal to simply 180 cos 30 is the motion, is the velocity in the horizontal direction, okay, that is the velocity, and the corresponding displacement in the x direction is Vx 0 into t, and these are the corresponding expressions that we have. Now, what do we want? We want to find out the horizontal distance, okay, when the projectile strikes the ground. Now, for that horizontal distance, what do we have? That y is equal to minus 150 meters. Now, what do? We use this equation and find out that for y is equal to minus 150, what is the corresponding time? So, we solve this and get that after time t, okay, is equal to 19.91 seconds, okay, by solving this quadratic equation, okay, and taking only the positive root, you will see that at t is equal to 19.91 seconds, we get this particle hitting the ground, and then correspondingly take that time, substitute here that this is the x distance covered by the particle in time t, which is nothing but Vx0 into time t, which is 155.9 into t. This will give us that the x distance, okay, when the particle hits the ground is approximately this value. Now, the second question we want to know is the maximum elevation, okay, when does it occur, okay, and at what value does it occur? So, to find out when does it happen, okay, at what elevation does it happen, we simply use this equation where we have velocity as a function of the y position. So, we just substitute Vy to be equal to 0, because at the maximum elevation Vy has to be 0, and substitute in here and solve this simple equation, and what do we get? When we solve this, we can solve this for y and get y is equal to 403 meters from here, or from the ground it will be 403 plus 150. So, that is the elevation from this level when the elevation will be maximum. Okay. Now, one simple concept question. You can prove to yourself, okay, you can prove to yourself that if you want to find out that if the particle is thrown, okay, from a bottom point like this without any elevation, and you are asked to find out what is the maximum distance in the x direction that is covered by the particle. That distance is called as the range of the projectile, and when the particle starts from 0, ends at 0, then you can convincingly show to yourself that, and the logic is like this, that when theta is extremely large, okay, let us say theta is equal to 90 degrees, then what happens? There is no x component, and because there is no x component, the particle will only go up and come down, as a result the range is 0. Now, let us take the other extreme case in which theta is equal to 0, okay, which means the particle is thrown perfectly horizontally. What happens in that case? In that case, the particle just stays on the ground, it never takes off. As a result, the range of the particle is again 0. So, in these two extreme limits, we see that the range is 0, and by some simple common sense, what you will realize is that because there is a range, there has to be some optimum value where the range will be maximum, and for a problem like this, you can see that the range will be maximum when theta will be equal to 45 degrees. You can even see it mathematically, okay, and mathematically also just substitute in the values, okay, look in any standard book if you have not already done this, okay. The range will be maximum, it starts from 0, end at 0, when this angle theta of launch is equal to 45 degrees, okay. Whereas now here it is asked, if you fire a projectile like this, what launch angle will be the greatest horizontal distance? So, first is 45 degrees, now 45 degrees clearly if it starts from here and end up here, okay, along this line, then 45 degree. But the question is what will happen? Now, that logic is very straightforward, okay, the logic is something like this. If theta is equal to 0, again nothing, the particle will go up and come down. Okay. If theta is now equal to 0 degrees, unlike the previous case, there will still be some range. So, what we are seeing here is that at 0 degrees also the range is not 0. So, overall what we are seeing is that the launch angle, okay, it is a simple, okay, you cannot rigorously show it with this simple argument, but argument is like this, that you are getting a range, okay, which is not 0 even at 0, okay, whereas previously to get some range, you needed to have, okay, at least, okay, you needed to have a large enough angle, okay, if you put theta equal to 0, you never got any range. So, with that logic, okay, you can just think that even at 0, I am getting some finite range. So, I would have some angle of projection, angle of launch less than 45 degrees, which will give me a maximum range. Okay. So, this is a very hand-waving answer. Okay. So, do not expect any rigor from it, but a simple logic is like this, that even at 0, you see some range, whereas previously at 0, you saw no range. So, just extrapolate and say that, so because at 0, you see some range, the maximum will be reached somewhere before 45 degrees. Okay. Very hand-waving answer, but you can also prove it rigorously. Now, another extension about motion relative to a frame of translation. Previously, what we had seen is that if you have some position vector along a straight line, then we had seen that RB was equal to RA plus R of B comma A. Now, here it is just straightforward. If the motion is happening not in a plane, okay, but it is happening along a curve and not in a straight line, then the XB and YB just are to be replaced by the corresponding vectors. So, what we will see is that if I have another frame, okay, so this is one fixed frame of reference in which, for example, you can measure what is the position of A, what is the position of B, what is the velocity and what is the acceleration of A and B in that frame. But suppose I am moving with this new frame, okay, which is with a moving observer A, then what we can say about the velocity of that from this frame, what will I see as a position of this point B, velocity of point B and acceleration of point B. And what we will clearly see is that from this frame which has origin at O, the position vector of B will be given as RB, but that can also be written as RA, which is this position vector, and using triangle law, this is R of B with respect to A. And what is this? R of B respect to A means that in this moving frame, okay, in the frame of this particle A, R of B comma A is nothing but what is the position it will see of B from this moving frame. Okay, only whatever we had done about relative motion, we are simply generalizing it to a general 3D motion. Okay, if you differentiate this once and twice, you will again see that velocity can again be written as VA plus V of B with respect to A. Same for the acceleration. The acceleration for B will be nothing but acceleration of A, but acceleration plus the acceleration of B with relative to A. Okay, and this is called as the velocity of B relative to A, and this quantity B slash A is the acceleration of B relative to A. You may ask that what is the big deal about these things, okay, why do we need to have these relative velocities, okay. So, even though we are not going to go into extreme details of these questions, okay, but what you can see is that there are many problems, okay, which are solved very well if you do not use some absolute frame, but you go to a moving frame. And these problems, for example, are especially important when we, for example, are in a rotating frame, for example, okay, if you want to, for example, analyze how weather pattern move, or for example, what is the, because Earth again is a moving frame. So, one gentleman had asked me a question about the moving frame of reference of Earth. So, our Earth actually is a moving frame, but we take that as a frame which is for us and move and measure everything with respect to that frame. So, as a result, because of a variety of problems, choosing not some absolute frame, but actually choosing a frame which is moving can actually become very easy for solving some problems. Okay, hopefully we will get time to solve some examples related to this. Okay, so a simple example that we have here is that automobile A, okay, is traveling in this direction, okay, which is given at a speed of 36 km per hour. Okay, automobile B, okay, is coming in this direction. What is it doing? Okay, this vehicle is coming in this direction at an acceleration of 1.2 meter per second square. Okay, what we are asked to find out, determine the position, velocity and acceleration of B relative to A 5 seconds after A crosses the intersection. Okay, so currently this is what the position is. Okay, these are the this is the acceleration for B. It starts from rest. This is the position. This is the initial velocity of A, and we are asked to find out that what is the position, velocity and acceleration of B relative to A. Now, this is a very straightforward problem. What you can do is that from the frame of reference of this road, which we now take to be the stationary frame, we can find out what is the position of A. You can take the origin here, you can say with respect to this origin, what is the position of A, what is the velocity of A, what is the acceleration of A. Similarly, with respect to this origin, we can find out what is the position of B, what is the velocity of B, what is the acceleration of B after 5 seconds, okay, just because using all the equations of motion that we have derived earlier. And once we get all these positions from this stationary frame, to find out what are the relative velocities, acceleration and position, we just do RA minus RB, VA minus VB and acceleration of A minus acceleration of B, okay. And a simple thing to do is that VA, okay, look at this one, after initial velocity is 36 kilometers per hour, acceleration is equal to 0, initial position is 0, this is the origin, okay, from the point of view of the road. So, what do we know? Okay, so VB 0 is 0, AB is equal to for the second motor B, velocity is 0 at this point, acceleration at B is minus 1.2y, because we have taken a frame in this rigid frame as x and y like this. This is x and this is y, because the acceleration in this direction, we take it to be negative minus 1.2 meter per second square, y a 0 is positive 35 degrees. What do we do? We find out, okay, what is the motion of automobile A, what is the velocity, straightforward, the velocity is given in kilometers per hour, we convert that into meter per second, there is a uniform motion for A. So, acceleration is 0 with respect to this fixed frame, velocity is just this, whereas the position, okay, after how much time? Time is equal to 5 seconds, is just given by x plus vt will be just, okay, this. Okay. So, what we know now vectorial, pay attention here now, that acceleration is 0, velocity is 10 meter per second in what direction? In the horizontal direction, and RA, the position is 50 meters in this direction. Okay. So, this is a vectorial representation. Now, we do the same thing for B. B, what do we have? We have the acceleration given to B, 1.2 meter per second square. Okay. We have velocity of B given as 0 minus 1.2 t, y minus 1.2 we just saw because acceleration is downwards with respect to this frame. Similarly, this is the position we put in the time, we get that the acceleration of B, okay, after time t is equal to 5 seconds is 1.2 meter per second square downwards. Velocity of B is 6 meter per second downwards, whereas the position of B, okay, put in the value t here will be 20 meter still upwards. Okay. So, all these values are given to us, and this is the acceleration, velocity, position, these are all vectors, these are also vectors for B, and there are two things we can do. We can solve this problem geometrically. Okay. So, what we can do is that to find out what is R of B slash A, means position of B with respect to A, what do we do? This is the position vector for A, this is the position vector for B, just note here 50, 20. And what is R of B comma A? Finish the triangle law, R of A plus R of B slash A, this is nothing but the position of B with respect to A, for the position that the B will see from his frame, okay, this is R B comma B A. We can use Lamé's theorem for example and solve this, we can use triangle law, whatever, and can solve this geometrically. Second, if you want to find out what is the relative velocity, what is the relative velocity of A? 10 meter per second, okay, in the horizontal direction, relative velocity of B is 6 meter per second in the downward direction. So, VA, V of B with respect to A, this triangle is completed, this will be the corresponding relative velocity of B with respect to A. And ultimately, we want to find out what are the relative acceleration. The acceleration is 1.2, okay, only for B, which is in a downward direction. So, we immediately know that the acceleration of B with respect to A is 1.2 meter per second downward square. So, essentially what it means is that if I am the passenger sitting in vehicle A, then the motion of B from my point of view will look like this, that this will be the position after 5 seconds, this is what will be the velocity I will measure from my frame, okay, like this, and this will be the corresponding acceleration which I, if I am moving in car A, is what I will measure for the car B. Or we can also use these vectors, so we can also write in terms of vector forms. Okay, that horizontal can be written as 50i, vertical can be written as 20j, write everything vectorially, solve it, and you will see that the answer can also be obtained in terms of ijk, okay, because it is a planar motion, there is no k. So, either you can do this geometrically or you can do it vectorially depending on what is convenient for you, okay, because some things are more convenient for some people, but they are both equivalent. okay. And a simple example now, that if we are sitting in a train, okay, B, okay, looking out of the window, in which direction does the train B, does the train A is moving, okay. So essentially what we want to know is that from my frame of reference, okay, what is the velocity of train A? And this can be very easily done using the vectorial approach. So what we see is this is the orientation of vector, okay. This is my velocity, I am sitting in train A, VB bar, okay. This is the velocity of train A from a fixed point of view or for the point of view of the ground, and what we know is that relatively this is V of A with respect to B, a vector, okay. So this angle, okay, is given to you some 25 degrees. So what we know is that this triangle is completed, and V A bar is equal to velocity of B plus velocity of A in the frame of reference of B. And note that this angle has to be less than 25 degrees clearly from this figure, and this cannot be possible, this cannot be possible, this horizontal cannot be possible. And just we saw from the triangle, okay, that the only way it can have is that it can, the direction has to be inwards like this, and it has to be little bit less than 25 degrees. Why? Because this magnitude is not 0, it cannot lie along this, it has to be lower than this. So the simple answer for this concept will be this. Now we come to the a very interesting part of kinematics, okay, which is tangential and normal components. That this was rectilinear motion. Previously what we did is that just a few moments ago we just said that the motion of a particle can be expressed, let us say take planar motion in the xy plane, it can be expressed in terms of the x coordinate plus the y coordinate and the corresponding unit vectors I and j in the x and y direction. But there are many alternative ways of solving these problems, and as we solve the problems, it will become clear that, for example, like for framing an x and y coordinate frame, what we need is we need some origin, okay. We need some origin, and with respect to that origin, we need to have a displacement vector x, so a position vector x, y, and then differentiate with respect to that and find out what is the velocity and the corresponding acceleration. But suppose, okay, that I am a rider, for example, and I want to figure out that what is the corresponding acceleration that I have just by looking at a local trajectory, just by looking at this local movement as opposed to fixing some origin and finding out all the motions with respect to that, okay. Those have clearly have some uses, but in many cases I don't care about what is the origin, I just need to know that when the rider, for example, is driving like this, what is the corresponding velocity and what is the corresponding acceleration relative, okay, not to some coordinate system here, but relative to what trajectory that I am seeing here. For example, if a train is moving, if I want to find out, not put some coordinate axis here and figure out that x and y coordinate of this train, but at this instant, okay, what is the corresponding velocity and what is the corresponding acceleration with respect to the trajectory that the train is following, without worrying about what some origin is somewhere here or not. Same goes for this roller coaster. I just need to know that if this is the trajectory, then here instantaneously what is the velocity and what is the acceleration without any reference to any origin system here, okay, just by looking at this trajectory. And in order to do that, one most effective way is to define what are called as the tangential and normal components of velocity and acceleration. So what is the tangential direction? So the tangential direction, okay, so if this is the path of a particle, of a train, of a mass, okay, or of a cart, anything you can think of, or of a ball, if this is the trajectory, okay, this is y, this is x, and the particle is moving in this plane. Now the tangential direction is defined simply as a tangent to this curve. Okay, we had seen earlier what is meant by tangent. So you draw a tangent to this curve, and that tangential direction, okay, draw a unit vector in that direction. Unit vector means E t comma magnitude is 1, and that unit vector is defined by this tangential direction, which is tangent to the path of the particle. And now it is very clear, we had seen earlier that a particle keeps on moving along this path, and as a result, by definition, the velocity has to be in this direction. Why? Because how is velocity defined? The particle is here, it moves a little bit distance of here, the corresponding displacement divided by delta t, when delta t goes to 0, is the velocity. But that is nothing that delta r bar in the limit when delta t goes to 0 is nothing but the tangential direction, and the magnitude is the speed. So what we realize is that when the particle is moving along a trajectory, the velocity vector is always directed along the tangent, or it is along this unit vector directed called et. And what is the corresponding velocity? Velocity is the magnitude v of t. What is t? Is the tangential velocity. Because why? Because velocity is always tangential. So v can be written as v, which is the magnitude of the velocity, times e of t. What is that? Is the direction. So once we say that the velocity vector is speed, okay, multiplied by e of t, we know what is the corresponding velocity vector. Now we need two coordinates. For example, in our Cartesian coordinate or xy coordinate frames, what do we have? We have I and we have j. Correspondingly, what do we have here? We have et. We take another unit vector which is perpendicular to this. Now how do we choose? Do we choose a en in this direction, or do we choose a en in the opposite direction? So the sign convention we follow is this, that I cross j is k. How does that k comes out? Okay, the k comes out of the plane using the right hand thumb rule. Similarly, we choose our en in such a way that et cross en is also equal to k. So that is called as defining a right hand coordinate system. So we define et, which is tangent to the curve, and en, which is normal to the curve. And by definition, okay, by definition of velocity, since this is the particle trajectory, the velocity of the particle at any point is nothing but the speed v multiplied by e of t. So this is what my v is. But now note one thing. When we dealt with the Cartesian coordinates, you see that I, j, k, or I and j, if you have a planar motion, that I and j always remained I and j. I always remained horizontal, okay? J always remained vertical, okay? So one remained horizontal, one remained vertical. But note here, this et is always a tangent. So what will happen is that if you keep proceeding along the trajectory, et will keep changing. And because en is perpendicular to et, such that et cross en is k, okay, you will see that et, en always keep on moving, and so these are called as moving coordinate systems. Okay. Now what do we do? We want to find out what is dv by dt, because we want to find out the acceleration, because many colleges, they had the question that what is the difference between kinetics and kinematics. Kinetics is just telling you that this is the trajectory I want to follow, but I may want to drive a car in a particular direction. But if, for example, it's a rainy day, okay, first rain, where there is, for example, there is some petrol spillage on the ground, the ground is extremely slippery. So no matter whatever I want to do, the ground friction will not allow me to do that. And will it allow me to take that turn? What are the forces involved? That can only be understood from dynamics. And in order to dynamics, to understand dynamics, we need to understand how the Newton's laws are applied, which is m times acceleration. So whatever we have, position, velocity, we need to ultimately find out the acceleration. And acceleration, how does it come? We just use chain rule. So acceleration will be dv by dt e of t. But we had just seen that this coordinate frame can keep moving, okay? And because this coordinate frame can keep moving, what you will see is that e of t will also change with respect to time. The direction of this unit vector, okay, it will keep changing. And so we have to use differentiation by parts. So acceleration will be dv by dt et plus v square by rho times det times en. Okay, now this derivation not difficult, okay, but not you have to just do some visualization. We'll come to that in the next slides, but just take my word for it for the time being. You can go into the derivations in details later. But what happens is that this can be shown, that det by dt, okay, times v will look as v square times rho times en. What is en? This is this en. So what do we know from here? Okay, just take this on the face value, that the acceleration has two components, as we had expected. That one component comes from the change in the speed. What is the direction of that component of acceleration? That component of acceleration has a direction which is tangential to the curve, okay, the curve that the particle is taking. Whereas the acceleration, because the particle is moving, okay, not only does the magnitude of speed change, but the direction also change, and the change in the direction is reflected in this term, okay, which is called as v square by rho. Rho will come to that in next second, is nothing but the radius of curvature here, or what is the radius of this trajectory, okay, times en, which is in this direction. Okay, so you can look at all the derivations. Okay, let us not go into the details of the derivation, because that will eat up a lot of time. Now what is the radius of curvature? Okay, let me briefly discuss that at this curve, for example, the particle moves from p to p prime in distance delta in time interval delta t, the distance it moves is delta s. Now, as I will quickly show a brief demo, what you can see is that you can fit a circle, okay, you can fit a circle here, okay, like this. What you will see here is that this is some arbitrary trajectory, okay, and this is a particle which is moving along this trajectory. Now, what is the radius of curvature? The radius of curvature is that at this point you can fit a circle, okay, which approximates the local part of the curve, and this particular thing is called as the radius of this curve is called as the radius of curvature, which is the quantity rho that we have used here. So, just look at this trajectory, okay, look at this trajectory here, and our intuition will fit like this, okay. Just look here, at this point of the trajectory it is pretty flat, the trajectory is very flat, okay. So, when the trajectory is highly flat, the second derivative of the curve with respect to the arc length coordinate will be very small, okay, and this is the radius of curvature, okay, okay. So, when the curve is very flat, the radius of curvature is very large, but when the curve, now note here, okay, so when the curve becomes very sharp, note this is a very sharp point, and when the curve is sharp, the radius of curvature decreases. Again, now the curve is becoming more and more flat, so the radius of curvature increases. Similarly, when the curve becomes sharp, the radius of curvature decreases, and that is the reason, for example, when we are, think about it, so when we are traveling in a very sharp curve, and since the radius of curvature is very low, look here, this rho goes in the denominator, and the acceleration is very high. So, we see that when we want to take a very sharp turn, we have to decrease our speed, because if we keep our speed also very high, then the acceleration becomes extremely large and the friction of the ground, okay, will not be sufficient to do that, okay, and also we will get dizzy if the acceleration becomes very high. So, this is the logic, that this rho is the radius of curvature. If the curve is very sharp, okay, the turn is very sharp, this rho becomes small, and if the turn is, if the road is completely flat, then this rho becomes infinite essentially. And so, if you are going on a flat road, this becomes 0. If you are going on a very, very curved road, this becomes very small and the acceleration drastically increases. And another name for this thing is called as a centripetal acceleration, which is something which we know a lot about. So, just to keep in mind, okay, so there are a lot of derivations, but a simple thing to keep in mind, that the velocity, okay, is simply given by VET, ET is the unit vector along the tangent, and the acceleration is simply given by this, okay. The tangential component is the, because of the change in the speed, and the normal component is because of the absolute value of the speed and the radius of curvature or the sharpness of the corresponding turn that we are taking, okay. So, this is one thing you have to keep in mind, due to change in speed, due to change in the direction of motion, okay. So, this is a sample problem. What we are asked here is that a motorist is traveling on a curved section of a highway of radius 750 meter and at a speed of 90 kilometers per hour, okay. So, kilometer, everything is given, the radius of curvature or the speed is also given to us. Now, we are given additional information, that knowing that after 8 seconds, the speed has been reduced to 72 kilometers per hour. So, it starts with 90 and it reduces to 72 kilometers per hour. Determine the acceleration of the automobile immediately after the brakes have been applied, means right here. So, this person sees this curve coming, okay, if we are sensible drivers, then what we do is that we are coming from a straight road, okay, we see a curve, we start slowing down by applying brakes. So, the curve starts from here, brakes are applied here, and after 8 seconds, the speed is 72 kilometers per hour. So, now what do we know is that the speed is now the tangential speed. So, what we know is that what is the tangential acceleration is what we know. But also another thing, in addition to the tangential acceleration, because this is a curved motion, even we are moving at a constant speed, we will have a centripetal force or a normal acceleration which is given by v square by rho. So, what do? We define our coordinate system, calculate the tangential velocity and tangential acceleration, normal acceleration, and overall magnitude of the acceleration. So, how do we find out the tangential acceleration? That this is 90, okay. This is the initial speed which can be converted into 25 meter per second, and 72 kilometer per hour is 20 meter per second, and the deceleration is how much? Okay, the deceleration from here to here, but nothing but change in the speed divided by time, okay, which is minus 6.625, okay, which means that the speed is actually decreasing. If this is t, the deceleration is in the direction which is opposite to the direction of the tangent. Now, immediately after the brakes are applied, okay, immediately, the speed is still 25 meter per second, which is 90 kilometer per hour. So, the acceleration is v square by r. R is given to us, okay, is how much? R is 750 meters. So, the tangential, the normal acceleration is nothing but v square by r, which is 0.833 meter per second square. The tangential acceleration from this figure you can see, because it's deceleration, the speed is decreasing. This is the tangential deceleration in this direction at this point. Correspondingly, the normal acceleration is 0.833 in this direction, okay? And the total acceleration can be found out, the magnitude, by just square root of a n square plus a t square, and the direction by tan inverse of a n by e t with respect to this point, okay? So this is one simple way where, for example, we don't have to refer to some coordinate axis which is x, y, and then do everything. There and then, by knowing what is the trajectory, we can find out what is the acceleration and what is the speed at what is the velocity at that particular instant, okay? So there is this one kind of a interesting question. This is from Beer and Johnston 10 slides from McGraw-Hill. They mentioned this interesting fact that is one of these race was scheduled because the normal acceleration, because the curves were so sharp for the velocities that the racing was happening, there was huge amount of normal acceleration. And what happens is that, so this is called as a G effect. Say for example, when fighter planes, for example, okay, this I looked up from Wikipedia, you can look up too, okay, that in fighter planes where, for example, like suddenly at very high speeds when sharp turns are taken, what happens is that the brain doesn't receive enough amount of blood, and so the fire, and so the pilots, for example, get dizzy. And in order to prevent that from happening, for example, one thing they can do is reduce the allowed speed or increase the turn radius, which cannot be done because the track is set, okay, but or have racers wear G suit. And what G suit is you can refer to in Wikipedia, is very interesting, that it applies pressure on the body and make sure that the blood doesn't drain to the lower extremities and brain still has enough supply of blood so that the passenger does not pass out, okay? So now we move on to the final topic of today's kinematics. Let us look at radial and transverse components. Now sometimes what happens is this, okay, that the xy coordinate system, okay, we need to have an origin. Means for example, if for example when flights are tracked, okay, this is another example from Beer and Johnston, the flights are tracked, they are tracked with respect to the control center, okay, with a radar. So what we know is that, okay, so if you have seen enough movies, okay, even I have seen only movies, not a real demonstration, that we see that with relative to this, the control center, you can see what is the position of the plane, okay, means the distance and the angle, okay. So there is an origin which is the control center, for example, and the corresponding distance is the radial distance and the corresponding angle is theta. So now in this case, instead of referring to xy coordinate frame, okay, or for example, if you want to understand what is the acceleration of this member which can rotate about this point, so this is a fire ladder, we need to set some coordinate system here, and this is an alternative way, okay. So instead of expressing that, expressing the position vector and the velocities in terms of xy, what we do is we express in terms of what is called as a unit vector in the direction, okay, so this is the origin. So rather than saying that this point P has a coordinate x and y, we say that it is at a distance of r and at an angle theta, which is measured clockwise. Why clockwise? Because infinitesimal angle clockwise, the vector direction is z, which is coming out of plane. So we are maintaining the right handedness of the coordinate system. So we say that if this theta is measured clockwise with respect to our axis, okay, then this is r bar, and this correspondingly, okay, the unit vector along this is called as er. And the corresponding vector which is perpendicular to it, such that ER cross product with E theta is again, okay, coming out of the plane. So the right handedness is mentioned, okay. Now you may ask that why not doing X and Y? What we will see is that sometimes the geometry of the problem is such that if you write expressions in terms of X and Y coordinate, then the derivatives become extremely, extremely cumbersome, and it is very difficult to understand what is happening. Whereas in some problems where we need to have an appropriate origin, but the geometry of the problem itself is nice and circular, okay, then this coordinate system becomes very easy. This particular aspect will become more clear when we solve problems in kinetics, okay. There are a bunch of problems, we solve them and you realize that this coordinate frame is much nicer, okay, for those particular problems with circular geometry. Now what do we have here? Straightforward, by definition, the position vector r bar of this particle with respect to a fixed origin. Now we need the origin. So with respect to this fixed origin, the position is given by r, which is the magnitude or the distance, multiplied by er bar, which is the unit vector along this. So r bar is equal to nothing but r er bar. Now what do we do? Note here again that if point P moves from here to there, again er does not remain constant. So this is again a moving coordinate frame, because er now will become in this direction. And so correspondingly er also changes, the direction changes, e theta ka direction also change. So what happens is that if now we want to find out what is the velocity of this particle, we do dr by dt, which is r dot, plus we also have to do dER by dt, and there is a derivation given here. We don't need to go into those details, but what we will see is that this dr by dt can be written as dER by dt r theta dot e theta. Now what we have here, that the velocity, as we had expected, it has a radial component. Why? Because if the particle tries to move outwards, then that is the r dot, and the component is in the this direction. But without changing this r, okay, keeping this r constant, like when we move in a circle, we can also have velocity. Why? Because the particle changes direction, okay, the position is this, the next position is in the other direction, okay, you have to move along the tangent. So that change in position will also induce velocity, and that velocity is given by r theta dot, and the magnitude is in the direction e theta. That is the physical meaning. Now go one step further. As we all know that in when we are applying Newton's laws, when you are doing kinetics, we cannot just stop at position and velocity, we have to go for acceleration. And acceleration is what? dv by dt. Just do all the math together, okay, the mathematics is given here, what we will see. So let us only understand what this means, okay. So acceleration will have two components. So one component in the radial direction, other component in the tangential direction, okay. So the radial direction, so er and e theta, I should not use the word tangential direction, it is in the theta direction. So sorry, please pardon me, this is not in the tangential direction, er is in the radial direction, e theta is in the perpendicular direction to this radial direction. So what are the two components? So r double dot, clearly that a particle, if it just starts moving outwards, okay, with some acceleration r double dot, we will have acceleration in this direction. But not only that, you also have minus r theta dot square. Now what is this minus r theta dot square? Remember we had v square, okay, divided by rho. So this r theta dot square acting in the inward direction is very similar to the acceleration that comes, just because even if the velocity remains constant, r dot remains constant, like the particle is moving, okay, that you are taking a stone, tying it to a row, to a string, and turning in a uniform circular motion, even in that case r remains constant. So r double dot is 0, but because you have theta dot or angular velocity, the theta dot is not constant, it is omega, which is the angular velocity, you will get this centripetal acceleration. Now coming to these terms, this r theta double dot. Now what is r theta double dot? R theta double dot just means that, for example, if I am not rotating this particle at a constant speed, but the angular velocity itself is changing, that theta dot is not constant, there is also theta double dot. Now what happens? So in the e theta direction, the particle speed keeps changing, and as a result, okay, for a uniform circular motion, e theta and the tangent direction are the same, but for any general motion, that is not the same, okay. But when the motion is circular motion, then e theta and the tangent both are in the same direction, okay, and normal direction and er are also the same. But think in that case that the velocity is constantly changing in the tangential direction, and as a result, this is the component, okay, that adds to e theta. Whereas the last term, this 2 r dot theta dot, it's a little bit complicated to understand, okay. So what happens is that if you try to move outwards, okay, then what is happening is that, think about it, you try to move outwards means your velocity is changing in the outward direction, okay. So that is, you are going out. But when you move out, because of this theta dot component, you will also see that your velocity in the tangential, in the normal, in this theta direction also changes, okay. And so the combination of those two changes give rise to what is called as 2 r dot theta dot. It is not very straightforward to understand, okay, but just think about it, okay. There is a figure that is given in the next few slides, think about it. But this is, you are trying to move in the radial direction, but when you try to move in the radial direction, not only are you having velocity there, but because your velocity in the perpendicular direction also changes, because the velocity in the perpendicular direction is what? R theta dot, okay. And since you move outwards, the r position changes, so the velocity components get added. And so this particular term is another, in non-inertial frame, this term is called as Coriolis force. And this can be easily be understood that, for example, if you have a rotating wheel, if, for example, like there are in parks, okay, that you have those wheels which are rotating about the circle, and you try walking from the center outwards, you will see that you will need to exert some force to create balance, otherwise you move sideways, okay, you will fall down sideways. So it is that force that you are trying to move in the radial direction, but this force is trying to push you in the direction which is perpendicular to the radial direction, okay. So all these derivations are given here, and you look, stare at this figure, okay, stare at this figure, and you will see that what are the various acceleration components that come here, okay. But the main thing you have to just realize that these are the various components that can come, okay, when you have radial and transverse components. And now we have our last sample problem. What do we have here? that the rotation of this arm. Now again, this problem makes it clear why we don't want to deal with XY system in this problem, but it is much better dealt with in R theta system or in ER E theta system. So what we have is that the rotation of the arm about O, okay, the arm rotates, okay. So we are looking it from the top, forget about like, well, don't worry about any gravity, nothing. This is pure kinematics. And this is an observation that I measure the rotation of the arm as a function of time. And what I see is that the angle theta, okay, goes as 0.15 t square, okay, as a function of time. Okay, this is given to us. Now, why is this like this will come when we do kinetics. Now, for this, caller B keeps sliding outside, okay. So this is again why this will happen can will come from kinetics, okay. So the caller B keeps sliding along this arm in such a way that R goes as 0.9 minus 1.2 t square, where R is in meters. Now what we are asked is that after the arm has rotated to 30 degrees, determine the total velocity of the collar, okay, after the arm has rotated to 30 degrees, okay. So what you want to find out, total velocity of the collar, this collar, total acceleration of the collar and the relative acceleration of the collar with respect to this arm, okay. So these are the three questions. Now what do? We first find out that this theta as a function of time is given to us. So what do? First we find out that when theta is equal to 30 degrees, what is the time? We put theta equal to 30 degrees, we get after that time, okay, after how much time will that happen? Second, evaluate radial and angular positions and first and second derivatives at t. Now we are given theta, just look at this expression. What do we want? We want r double dot, we want theta dot, we want r dot and we want theta double dot. So essentially we want r double dot, theta dot, theta double dot. These four components is what we want. Are we given those components? We are already given. We are given theta as a function of t. So theta dot will be 0.3 into t, theta double dot will be 0.3. R is also given to us. So we can find out r dot and we can find out r double dot. Okay? So all the quantities can be found out by us. So r dot, r double dot, theta, theta dot, theta double dot. Now everything is there either as a constant or a function of time. Now we see that theta is equal to 30 degrees. At time t is equal to 1.8 seconds. So we substitute all those values here to find out what is r double dot, theta double dot. And from that, when theta is equal to 30 degrees, one thing we should note that when theta equal to 30 degrees, we also know what is ER just along this. What is E theta is also we know. So we also know then that AR is the acceleration in this direction is nothing but r double dot minus r theta dot square, just put it in. Acceleration theta direction is r theta double dot plus 2 r dot theta dot, just put that in and you will see that this is acceleration in the theta direction minus, what does that tell? That this is e theta, the acceleration in the theta direction is actually in this direction, okay. Velocity is nothing but r theta dot, okay. If you look here, what is velocity is r dot plus r dot is in the direction er, r theta dot is in the direction e theta. Put that in, we will know what is the velocity in the this direction and in the perpendicular direction, and then we can find out what is the resultant velocity and so on, everything we get. Now the last part of the question is the interesting part, the relative acceleration of the collar with respect to the arm. Now note one thing, that what is happening, that this collar has the same motion as the arm and in addition it has this motion along the radial direction with respect to this. So think about it, that the acceleration for this will be nothing but at this point what is the acceleration for this collar, okay, which is already there, okay, plus what is that extra which comes in this direction. So essentially what do we have, that the motion of the, so A of B with respect to this O, OA which is this arm is nothing but R double dot, because why? Because everything else, okay, is already a part of the collar, so it is only R double dot, okay, which will decide what is the relative acceleration, because if I am sitting on this rod, okay, if I am rotating on this rod, then the only acceleration I will see is that that in my frame of reference which is rotating with the rod, I will see that the collar is only moving outwards, okay, and the only component for that is r double dot, and that is what we will see here, okay. So with this much of a preamble, what we have done is that with like lot of kinematics essentially that are required, okay, so we took a lot of time with this, but it was very important. Why? Because all the kinematics is absolutely mandatory for any kind of kinetics or using Newton's laws, because once we know kinetics appropriately, we are done. Newton's laws become really straightforward once our kinematics is absolutely fine. Okay. So center number 1203, they say would you please explain the difference between centrifugal and centripetal forces? Okay, we will discuss this in great details when we go to kinetics. Note that when we are in an inertial fixed system, okay, in an inertial system, what is an inertial system? The inertial system is a system which moves, okay, at a uniform velocity. Whereas an accelerated system or a non-inertial system is like, for example, when you have a train which keeps on braking every now and then. So if a train keeps moving uniformly and I am present in the train, then I am present in an inertial system. But for example, if the train keeps braking or it keeps like going around curves, okay, then the train is accelerating. And then that frame of reference is called as the inertial reference frame of reference for a spinning particle. For example, if you take a stone and spin it in a circular motion, then if you are in a coordinate frame which is rotating along with the stone, that is called as a non-inertial frame of reference. And in that frame, of course, I will not see any acceleration for the stone. But then I am seeing that there is also tension in the string. So how do I explain that? So to explain that, what do I say is that there is a force called as centrifugal force, which is acting and which is pushing this thing outside. So centrifugal force, we say to that when we are in the moving frame of reference with the rotating disc or with the rotating stone. Okay. Whereas if I am on a fixed frame of reference, okay, and I am seeing that the stone is being rotated around in a circle, then in that case I will see that to keep that stone in the circle, the tension in the string is applying an internal force, and that force is the centripetal force. It is going into the center. So from an inertial frame point of view, you have a centripetal force. Whereas if you are in a non-inertial frame, and we are not going to deal with non-inertial frames in this course, then what you see is a centripetal force. It just depends on what frame of reference you are in. So 2-1-2-1-5, say please explain hodograph. I think you just have a look at that. It is not a crucial concept. Okay, so it just that like we have position vector, we have a velocity vector, and then correspondingly whatever velocity vector velocity is, like what is the curve that is traced, is called as a hodograph. Not important. Okay, not important at all. In a projectile motion, why do we take, the question is by 1172, it is by TCEBEM 1172, they have asked the question in projectile motion, why do we take the negative value of acceleration due to gravity? That negative value is purely because our coordinate frame is chosen, that y is upwards, x is sideways. You can take your y downwards, okay, and then your g will become positive, just because of the way we have chosen the coordinate frame and nothing else. So center number 1108, they have asked, okay, why the horizontal component of velocity in projectile motion is constant? Okay, so it is constant because there is no acceleration. The acceleration is only due to gravity. In the x component, for example, there is, unless and until there is some air drag, which in this first course, okay, we just don't worry about it. Okay, we just say okay, it's small. Okay, the air drag is small compared to the inertial, compared to all the other forces. Air drag is small. We forget about it. In that case, there is no acceleration that acts on the particle in the horizontal direction. So there is no reason for us to say that the particle will have any deceleration in that direction. So velocity has to remain constant, because v is equal to v plus at, where a is the acceleration. Since a is 0, v remains constant. Then there is another question which is asked by 1122. What is the role of jerk in kinetics? Okay, it's a very nice question. So note one thing, jerk is what? The rate at which the acceleration changes. Now jerk is not a fundamental quantity in kinetics. Why? Because Newton's law, force is equal to m times a, at least for particles, okay, or particles, or for only translational motion, f is equal to m times a. So jerk doesn't enter into that picture at all. But why is jerk important? Jerk is important because if you want to design, for example, a track, okay, if you want to design a road, if you want to design a path in which, for example, a vehicle should go, then in that case, if you want to have a motion which is jerk free, then you have to make some arrangements such that those components are nullified. Okay, so jerk in kinetics, it does not directly come, but it comes for us that we want to make sure that for our ride, for vehicles, for example, that if we want to have as comfortable ride as possible, then we should have as little jerk as possible. And in that case, for example, we want to make sure that our trajectory is such that the acceleration doesn't change appreciably when we move along the paths. The role of jerk in kinetics is from the point of view of design. From the point of view of Newton's laws, okay, it is not particularly relevant. But how do we do appropriate designs for cars, for roads, okay? Or for example, what are the appropriate forces we should be applying to change the acceleration and so on, okay? So in that sense, jerk is important, but it is not a fundamental quantity. So with this one, okay, we'll take a break.